I should probably take the chat out. Yeah, I thought maybe by breaking down the project, maybe it will inspire someone else, because you can see a bit of the inside of the track. Okay, so immediately this piano isn't playing. So when I made those stems, I actually took a different piano. Let me just... Oh, it's from a different expansion. Let me just take this piano. Grand piano. Okay, I think we can work with this. So it's obviously not the original, but now, this piano really doesn't sound like the original. Wait, let me... What are my neighbors doing? Holy crap. This one sounds more like the original. The piano makes it sound like a live cover of the song. I should make an acoustic version. I'm gonna sing it. So yeah, very simple. It might look like a lot, but it's like nothing at all if you see this, because this is only track till track 7. This is all just drums, so an instrument, it's just literally just this. There's like almost no layering. The project is way more simple than I imagined. Yeah, it is very simple. So here we just have our piano with let me see what... God, my mic is taking my view. With OTT on the piano, some equalizing, and a vocodex. Okay, I use vocodex reverb. Vocodex has reverb presets that I like to use. I like the sound of it. And I used it on the piano here. No, Sloopy, so it's not the vocoder effect that you think. Like, if you open up vocodex, obviously you get that. But if you go to the reverb preset, and you turn off draft, and you cut out the low end, it creates a really nice reverb that kind of sounds like voices. I love this reverb of vocodex. I use it a lot. So yeah, I use that. So the vocal that you hear is this. Let me see what a post-processing it has. A picture, obviously. So picture is Fruity Loops' FL Studio's auto-tune plugin, native. So this is the vocal without auto-tune, and it's pitched up. Let's see, copy value. Let's put this to reset. So that's the vocal. That's really bluesy, really jazzy. So I pitched it up, auto-tune on it to the key of the tracks with a format filter. Oh, let me just play the vocal. So that's it. It just it loops, and then in the second part, I brought the pitch a little down so it follows the melody, you know. The drums are these. So in FL 21, we're finally gonna be able to just click on a group. you know, nowadays I would put everything in a group like this. You know, drums. Oh, let me not group it to this. Yes, group it to this. This one, not to this. And in FL 21, we will be able to just turn like mute solo our group. Finally, they have confirmed this on the forums. Like what Ableton, of course, could do from the beginning, and any other DAW, just FL is late with it. So you know, and now I still have to like turn on separately every. So annoying. So in my intros, I always like to use some more percussive sounds, some more roomy sounds. Very little post-processing. And standard, I'll have a choir in the background. Which is usually, especially back in the day, I would use a lot of the Fruity Loops just to stock choir. Yeah, this is the Fruity Loops stock choir in direct wave. I think you can find it here in Beck's, what was it, Instruments, Orchestral. And I believe that this is the direct wave one. Direct wave is sick, by the way. You can just load up samples in your in direct wave and play with them. Wait, can I show you guys that? I don't really use this a lot, but now that I open direct wave, I know that it's something you can do. So let me open a direct wave. Right now there's nothing because you have to import a sample. If I'm not wrong, you can just grab anything. Where do I drag it in here? So now we have it in here. And you can... the cool thing about direct wave is that you can layer it with other sounds. Let me add a kick for more difference. Hear that? So now it's all layered, and you can change a lot of stuff. My CPU is going crazy. Let me just switch smart disable. Yo, Rogue, how are you? You're such a good friend of helping your friend out with moving. Always a fun job. The percussion is really funky. Oh yes, I love using percussion. So yeah, I'm just breaking down Get to You right now to maybe inspire some people by showing you some of the inside tricks. Like always, I have a choir in my drum set tracks. If anybody wants to see the MIDI, well, here you go. Make a print screen right now. Because these are the main chords. Let's see, what is this sweep? This seems to be coming from just some pack. Oh, that's actually... wow, that's from my really old sample pack. Okay. The guitar. I actually bought a guitar this week, so I'm gonna finally record my own guitar samples again, like back in the day. But here, I believe I just used some sample pack. Where's the guitar? Yeah, so here we have. So this whole sample is this. I've clearly sped it up. So I just took parts of that, just chopped it up. What's the post processing on this? Just OTT. As you can see, I didn't even bother to do anything else with it. I was like, it sounds good. It just has some nasty OTT on it. It's not even sidechaining because it's in the offbeat anyway. Spaghetti on his Carlos Santana. Wait for it, man. You're gonna forget about Carlos Santana. Okay, so here we go into the vocal section. So this is the original vocal. It is original vocal is this. It's from a royalty-free sample pack.
Our love ought to place in my mind, trying to find a way to get to you. I love all the place in my mind.
And then with post-processing.
Our love ought to place in my mind.
So I put in a picture on it. Like I said, it's basically autotune of FL. It has some pretty hard OTT, a very short delay, a little bit of cutting in the equalizer.
Our love.
Looks like there's a high pass on it, but it's very low. Oh, that's probably for later. Well, just cutting out the low end. And then there's a lo-fi filter on it, and I believe that I used that in the build-up. How helpful is Pitcher? I've honestly never used it. It's super helpful. I use it a lot. I will admit that it's not a great... It's not super accurate. Like, the artifacts that it generates are not very pretty. So Pitcher works well if you are, for example, pitching as a vocal. It's good if it's side-changed to get a bit rid of those artifacts, that you're like covering the artifacts. In this case, I believe it's already in key, the vocal, or I pitched it to in key. Is G minor. I might have actually adjusted the project to the vocal pitch, because I don't produce in G minor a whole lot. Also, big sorry to everybody who's remixing that it's in G minor. Piano just continues, the percussion, the kick drum is out. I add an arp, which is just a 3 oscillator in Fruity, which I believe is like operator in Ableton. Let me see how many are there running. Yeah, so it's all just saw waves, or the sine. And then here in Fruity, in the, this section here, you can arpeggiate every sound that's in the sampler. So one arpeggiator will be in minor, and then I'll have a second one for all the chords that are major. So they'll follow each other up. So these are minor. That's a major. So the D chord in this chord progression is a major. I didn't use FL. Change it to D sharp. Yeah, you can do whatever. I mean, I'm just saying, yeah, for the people that would like to keep it close to the original, it's in G minor. But it's, you know, it's for the sub bass. It's not very low. It's not very deep. But, you know, it fits with the original track, in my opinion. The track is not a track that you... You know, it's not typical being played in clubs. It's better. It's better listenable on the less good systems too. In that range, you know, when you go E minor, D sharp minor, there's a lot of systems where that sub bass will disappear. You know, the lower frequency. I saw a question from someone that I wanted to answer. G minor, but have a variation, not this F sharp. Yeah, I mean, do whatever you want with the remix. It's all up to you what you want to do. Blow me away with anything crazy you want to do. How did the vocal sound for you? Ableton has a complex pro mode that cleaned it up. Yeah, that's in FL Studio. Here we have elastic mode, it's called. I believe... Here's one for speech, but I believe for singing, in general, you want to use either... Elastic generic or legacy elastic transient or generic. These are like my most used for if you want to keep things slick and clean. Obviously mono and speech are really, and slice stretch are really, really sick for like bass creation, sound design. But yeah, let's continue here. So here we have there's not much of a rise of a build-up at all. It's super simple, this project. You know, a song doesn't always have to be difficult. It doesn't have to be. It doesn't have to have 100 million layers to have impact. So here's a riser. It's a Cymatics riser. Very simple. Any post-processing? Just reverb. Another sweep from my own pack. Did I do any post-processing? No, just some cutting some low frequencies. Ah, someone asked about cutting low frequencies, if I do hard cuts. I don't do a whole lot of hard cuts. It depends on what it is, though. Like, on my mid-basses, I'll do harder cuts. But samples where I'm doing a low cut, a low frequency cut, that I know that don't have too many frequencies in the lows anyway, I don't always do one. I'll let it go up easily, so it feels... To make your track sound full, you don't always want to go for full hard cuts. Sometimes you can actually use the frequencies of a sound that are spread out. You can use that to fill up your track where needed. So yeah, obviously the vocal just builds up. Our guitar continues. So the vocal goes down here. So that's I do that with effector, but you can use any bit crusher or lo-fi effect. Thing. It's an old project, and I've lost I lost my Slice Beats folder, so a lot of shit is gone. So I lost this effect that I had in the middle here. But I do think I can see the post-processing of it. Let's see which one it is. That's why this pre-drop wasn't also in the stems either, because like it's gone. I don't have it anymore here. I do believe it's just the vocal... It's just a vocal with a bit speak, like a bit crusher effect on it, and then pitched a little. And maybe equalized with some sort of, telephone booth kind of effect. Like a ramble, but it's mostly bit speak, the effect called bit speak that does the work. I can show you guys really quick, I guess. Maybe I can just remake it. So if I have the sample here. Wait, let me... Consolidate this part really quick. MediaFire is fine, yeah. I prefer Dropbox, but MediaFire is okay too, I guess. So if I have here the effect, I'll add BitSpeak on it. I believe that's pretty much the effect that I did. Maybe some extra OTT on it or just some equalizing, get some harsh sounds out. So yeah, BitSpeak is an amazing plugin. If you guys didn't have it yet, grab it. It's I don't think it's very expensive. So let's go to the drop. You're gonna answer the email for confirm you listened to the song, or how know if you listened it? That is actually a good question. I'll probably do it. I'll probably email you back or let you know in another way. That's a good question. Since this is probably my first competition where I'm gonna have so many submissions. I'll keep it in mind. I'll discuss that with my team. Don't worry, I'm gonna hear everybody's remixes. Are you gonna stream for listening to the remixes? Oof. I was thinking of doing that. I'm first gonna see how many there are, and then I could do like a fun, 48 hours stream probably for all the submissions. But I don't think I will, to be honest. What I might do is make a select. My first thought was to listen to everything on my own time. in my free time, and I'll make a big selection and then do a stream where I'll pick the winner, you know, where I'll do live judgment. That's probably what I'm gonna do, but I'll let you guys know on my social media. Roke, you need to urinate. Okay, you're allowed to go. You may go. You're dismissed. Sloopy Music says your Bitspeak basses in Bomb are so neat. Bitspeak basses? I might have used Bitspeak on the basses, yeah, probably. Good news, you're dressed also. Thank you, Roke. Let's go to the drop. Yeah, I used Bitspeak on the vocals. On the vocals for sure. Some heavy, heavy Bitspeak. Let me add a marker really quick. Oh, drop. Drop one. It's so annoying. People, I have a... take this off. I have this keyboard, which is a gorgeous mechanical keyboard, but since it doesn't have the function keys, I had to like remap my keyboard, and which was a hell of a job. And I still have to get used to that, man. And exactly right now, I'm like, I have to watch over my mic. So anyway, here we're in the drop. Now we have these drums. Very simple drums. Look, again, I have to go to FN. Cymatics kick with some equalizing. Why is my MIDI not working? There we are. Okay, here also some equalizing. A clap. Spec out here using Cymatics kicks? Yeah, why not, man? I'm happy that someone else spends hours to make kicks for me. I don't enjoy it too much making my own drums. Every now and then I'll make a snare real quick, but or a kick maybe for an off for a fill, but not really for the seriousness. What would it sound like if you take the faded clap off? Then you have this. Okay, here it is definitely high end missing. Revocal, making your own drums is a thing that most people lie about. What do you mean? People lie about making them? They just make their own transient usually. Yeah. I have seen that, yeah. People, it's easy to make a punchy transient, but what people do is they just take samples that exist. So, or use like, make the tail, they'll just take from an existing kick or from like a tom or whatever. Yeah. Make my own drums, layers, cashmere, top kick with a decap kick. Sounds sick. Yeah, I mean, I've done that too, but I'm not one of those people that spends hours making drums. I don't enjoy it that much. I prefer just making melodies, trying to get songs done. I prefer spending my time on that. Okay, so let's go into the basses. Well, in the offbeat, we have the vocal and the guitar from the beginning. So that's still the same. So let's go to just the basses. So here we have a little stack. Let me see what this is. So it's Nexus, Ecopunk Dance Lead. So that's a pretty pretty simple super saw. Just some OTT and very little equalized cutting. What else is in the stack? Just a good old chrome, a good old Buried Alive unit. You know, just to fill up that, that layer. And then for a little higher layer here, this one. In massive. I use electric a lot. The electric wavetable and math, rough math two. That combination of one electric and one math two. So that rare bass is, it sounds like Harmer. This bass is. Is it this one? No. It's grown. Man, my. Okay, there we go. I couldn't see it well. So it's massive. Okay, if I turn number LFO 5 off. So if LFO 5 is connected to the band reject and a band pass. And it sounds like I'm pitching something too. That might be envelope 6. LFO 6. I think the reverb does. Okay, is this... It's actually this... what is this macro? Sorry, people. I haven't looked at this project in ages. Well, just to make the stems, but I haven't looked into the presets. This is from a long time ago. Okay, so macro 3 is making that movement. Yeah, macro 3 is connected to the pitch of the phase modulation. Okay, yeah. I use a third oscillator here. Gotcha. So yeah, there you go. That's the bass. But what I liked about this project is I wanted to make a drum step track that was not just pure heavy basses. Like, it's melodic, so the guitar and the vocal play a much bigger part than usually in my drum step tracks. Keeps it more fun, in my opinion. You know, without the vocal off thing, it's just this. Wait, what's this? Okay, I do have a little bass. Okay, let's investigate. Short sign. So that's this one. Again, electric and rough math 2 with a bandpass filter. Oh, what's the post-processing on all these babies? OTT and some equalizing. And on that main bass... On the main bass, we have... As you can hear, not too much of a difference. OTT, a little bit of vocodex reverb. And some reverb. Ah, no, that's probably a bigger reverb for some offbeat effects. What if the kick happened twice as often? Okay, let's make this rhythm. That's actually not bad. Let's turn up this clap. Pretty cool. This riff is this. So it's this super saw with a single layer of Nexus. I use Nexus a lot. It's so easy. Sounds are so full. What else is in the stack? Sub bass, and what's this grungy? Okay, this grungy is silent already. I didn't expect that. It looks like a Vandalim preset. With an extremely heavy distortion, overdrive distortion in silent. So together, you know, you want to have in the spectrum, every frequency you wanna feel it. So sub for the lows, the grunge for like the mid lows, super saw and a lead for like the mid high and the high. And of course the vocal goes with the melody too. Yeah, here's that reverb effect on the bass. Maybe without reverb, it just cuts. So that was just a fruity reverb, I believe. Yeah, it's just a fruity reverb. Yeah, I love making these riffs. So here it's a double riff. It sounds like there's another bass in here. This one. So terrible, barely alive Chrome AI bass, but layered with the rest, it just gives that nice little spice. Like you hardly hear it, but it's there. It's, you know, it fills it up. It fills the space up where it needs. Yeah, and here's again a slice beat that's gone. Yeah. So yeah, I mean, that's really it. There's some new basses coming here, but yeah, I'll discuss that bass in a minute. I just wanted to say the sidechain technique I used here. Let's see. Okay, I was already working with Volume Shaper at the time. In that time, someone on YouTube convinced me that it was better to have not a hard cut at the beginning, so not all the way here, but like just on that first snap off of it. Someone had a theory about that the clickiness would be less. So that's what I did. Nowadays, I actually do it all the way to the beginning. Since the project is done, I'm not going to touch it. That's just how I did it. But yeah, here you got to pull it all the way to the end so that the sidechain doesn't stop. For people who don't know Volume Shaper, it's literally just, you know, as if you automate, if you put a fruity balance and you automate your volume. But here you can just draw the volume. You can draw that automation in here and you'll have it. So you have it triggered by a MIDI out. So you add a MIDI out, put it to a port number, whatever one you want. You can put 12 as long in your sidechain channel, you put the input on the same one. So input port 12 in this case. But I mean, what I've been doing this week and last week, the thing is, if you use Volume Shaper, it is a third-party plugin. It doesn't generate any latency, so it's not too heavy. However, I do notice a difference. What if I just... Okay, I don't see it right now immediately on the CPU. But in bigger projects, I definitely notice if I turn Volume Shaper on and off that it costs some CPU. So a cheaper way for your CPU would be to link all your instruments to your sidechain channel here, route it to your sidechain. Just take a fruity balance. Let me insert one. Take a fruity balance. Automate it. Oh, and while you're at it, copy the value and then go to a max and paste the value so that it's always on the top. And then you just automate your sidechain like this. And then on the kick and the snare, of course. You know, that's another way to do it. It's better for your CPU. I mean, you can do both at the same time. What I do as well is I'll just make another one to sidechain. If you want to have your sounds close down right before the next kick. You can do that, you know. So you can use it for the second sidechain. So let's see what this new bass is. Sounds like Massive. I think that the reverb here does a lot of the effect, to be honest. Yeah, you can hear that. You see how the reverb here makes all the space and all the movement. So I just have a slow, just a 1-on-2 LFO on the reverb size. So, but it's very little, so that when you change the size of a reverb, you can always hear like a pitch distortion, right? That's what I used here in this bass to create that wow, that crying, that moaning kind of sound. The bass is called Arab. There's an EQ in the volume shaper. Oh, I didn't even say that yet. Yeah, that is a big difference. Produced in. Again, Vocodex. For that reverb. As you can see, it's hard OTT on 68%. Maximus. Okay, Maximus just works as a soft clipper here, basically, as a limiter. A little bit of equalizing, and then another OTT that's a little less heavy. But with the highs and the mids brought down a little. I just saw a question I wanted to answer. Oh yeah, the sidechain. So, back to Volume Shaper. In Volume Shaper, you can make three frequencies. So you can make a low band, a high band. So you can draw different shapes for... If you want to have your lower frequencies sidechain different than your higher, then you can hear, you can split. You can see the hertz there. You can split where you want to sidechain. So that's really, really cool. Saves you a lot of trouble like making all this stuff in your FX slots. So in general, you want to have your higher notes a bit faster, and then the lower you go. Correct me if I'm wrong, but I think that's the correct way to do it. The lower you go, you want to sidechain a bit more, a bit harder. But yeah, in general, I'll just use mid and high, but more just mid. You know, if I'll use high, I'll just go to like, what, like 5K probably, 5K hertz. You should try out Cyberpunk 2077. It still has to come out, right? Looks amazing. I saw some trailers. It looks freaking amazing. Let me take away this fruity balance just to be sure. And I've been messing with Volume Shaper. Well, it doesn't matter. Okay, we heard this bass by now. So this bass here sounds like a sine wave in Massive as well. Yeah, it's just a very simple, had the old school 24 pitch up, 24 pitch down. So here I layer it with a bass called Rango, and here it's called Pokemon. Don't ask me why. So this is such a gnarly sound, and it's so easy to bit crush, a bit of Browner tube, band pass, and then a Vulgar wavetable with a Rough-Mat 2 wavetable. So this is probably just the same bass but pitched higher. Is it the same bass or is it... Yeah, it's literally the same bass, it's just an octave higher, that's it. Okay, and again, here's some middle part gone because of the slice beats. So in post-processing on that, I used glitch for a tape stop effect. For tape stop effects, I use nowadays, this one by the way, kilohertz tape stop. This is the entire plugin. You just have to automate the play and pause. That's it. That's cool. Yeah, and now basically all the same instruments repeat, but with some variation, I think. Oh, well, hold on. The second drop is, of course, with the sine wave, the distorted sine wave thing. So, for the rest of the drop is the same, it's just, this bass is different. Here's our old school classic sine wave thing. So it's just like I just said earlier too. Come on, leave me. The plus 24, minus 24 with a pitch modulation here, a very fast attack on the pitch. A little bit of phase modulation. Makes it a little grittier. It's almost nothing. But the most grit comes from the sine shaper here. Which is basically distortion. And here's more distortion, a full-on classic tube, and a scream filter, obviously. Man, I will forever love that sound. And some reverb on it too. What is the post-processing? There it is, people. Ladies and gentlemen, our Soundgoodizer. There it is. OTT. Let's see it without post-processing. It's like very, very mono, very, very clean, but you know, a little boring. It's mostly the vocodex reverb that actually does the work here. This dimension expander can go. Then I used here's Brainworks to make it to make the signal a little wider, and here down here you can see too, I made the signal a little wider, a bit more stereo. All right, this for the stereo shaper can also go. But yeah, like I was saying earlier, look how much that vocodex does. So you open up vocodex, you go to the wider the reverb 2 or reverb 1, and then here with this release you can make it shorter, and then you get a real nice roomy effect. I always cut a low end a bit, but I just saw that in this sine wave I didn't cut much low end, and I also turned down the vocodex in general a total a bit. There's no low end cut, but it doesn't matter because there isn't much in the original signal, and there's an end boss cut off here in the low frequencies until about, you know, the snare frequencies. Soundgoodizer, no cap, generally good saturator. I mean, Soundgoodizer, I use it on my sub sometimes as well. I do. But whenever I use it, it's usually about, you know, here. Can you see a percentage anywhere? No. Well, it's about, you know, about like a quarter in. And Ivory, I'm good, bro. How about you? I'm good, man. I was actually about to DM you and show you something that you saw you were streaming. Alrighty. Well. you can still DM me, bruh. Yeah, it's such an easy project, so I'm like almost through it already. The rest of the second drop, it's pretty much all the same instruments. I think we didn't look at these. We did look at the stack. So, altogether, it's that. And so this is probably, again, just a lower octave of that same bass. I made a different version, so maybe I did some more changes here. So as you can hear, especially back in the day, I used the reverb effect in Massive. I use an LFO on the size of the reverb, and with that I create a room and pitch modulation. I used to do that a lot in Massive. So it makes it super wide, but it also makes the whole sound really. And band reject. In Massive, I would almost always use band pass and band reject for filters. And scream. A good old reversed kick here. So you just take a kick. You just reverse it and there you go. Magic, what's your sub in this project? Good one. I don't think I showed you guys yet. So the sub bass is probably a Massive. So it's just a sine wave with some parabolic shaper to give a bit of distortion. And then here's some classic tube distortion and a low pass filter to cut out high frequencies. In the equalizer, I bring down all the high shelf and the frequency as well. Yeah, that's pretty much it. Post-processing, nothing other than this equalizer, just to cut it off at, it starts at 139 hertz to, you know, just below 200 hertz, and then a low cut here as well. This is kind of important, that people, in this low end, this is not audible, you can't hear this, but it is there in your system taking up space, so you want to cut like a little here, just like at the 130 hertz. You can see I had a Maximus on my sub. Okay, I had a Maximus on my sub that I pumped everything up, as you can see. Went higher. And then later I turned it off again. Okay. On my master, I have Ozone 7. Wait, let me play the song and then we can listen to the difference. Actually, let me close everything. I was going to show you guys the master, because I think that's the only thing that's left in this project to still show you. Yeah, that was pretty much everything. So let's go to our first drop. On my master, I have Ozone. And if I turn it off, So in my ozone, I almost always have a side cut frequencies and then a dynamics, which is basically multi-band compression, what for me works as a soft clipper, you know, because it limits everything at zero. And yeah, by default, I believe everything is at minus 12 and I just crank everything up to zero. So it just works as a limiter. And then I just have a little bit of tape saturation in the, just for the sub bass, you know, just under the 140. So just for the kick drum and the sub bass. Yeah. 640. All right. I think that's it for me today. my throat hurts like crazy. I need to go get something to drink. I just wanted to show you guys the project of Get to You. I hope you guys maybe took some inspiration from it.